lecture, j'ai interdit une habitude Pascal Hubert. So I'm happy to introduce Pascal from Marseille, and he will speak about transition surfaces and interval transformation.
So thank you very much, Erwan, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to explain the little thing I know on this subject. My goal is to speak about non-generic interval exchange transformations and translation surfaces. But first of all, this course will be extremely elementary. And I want to recall basic facts. So for those who know, it's good because it is after lunch, so you can sleep. What I will explain is really, really elementary. At the end of his talk this morning, Chris made a very nice picture, and I want to say a little bit more on this picture, in a sense. I want first to give definitions. So the definition of a translation surface is the following. I take polygons in the plane. And I glue sides by sides. To make a surface, a compact surface. And the best is to see examples. So I give a baby example. And in fact, this is the first one, which is the torus. This is a translation surface. I want to give examples that Matthäus will explain in the next talk, which are called square tile surfaces. So surfaces made as a union of a unit square. And I identify like that, for instance. So this is also a translation surface. And the third example is this one. It is supposed to be a regular octagon. And I identify parallel sides together. First exercise. Prove here that this is a compact surface of genus 2 in both cases. G will be the genus and is equal to 2 for the examples I gave. Also something which is related to Chris' lecture. As you know, translations are holomorphic maps. So translation surface is a Riemann surface. Okay. is a Riemann surface, and you have more structure. Locally, we have charts which correspond to dz in the plane, and this is what is called a holomorphic one form. Locally, we have a structure which is dz, but I will. So I have a very concrete model, and today I will speak about this concrete model. But I want to say that for people who prefer an analytic point of view, a translation surface is exactly a Riemann surface plus a holomorphic one form. Okay. And and what is clear is that this is flat. So we have a flat metric. And it is not possible to have a metric which is flat everywhere on a surface of genus 2, for instance. It is only possible in genus 1. And if you look at this example, you can check that all these points are the same. So this is part of the exercise. And if you compute the angle around this point, it is not 2 pi, but it is 6 pi. So we have to pay a price to get something which is flat. It is impossible to have something, a flat metric everywhere, but we have conical singularities. And since we identify sides by translation, the angle around a point is a multiple of 2 pi. Because when we identify, and we come back to the same side, it is by a translation. So it is the angle is some number times 2 pi. Okay. And for those who know, this conical singularity corresponds to the zeros of the holomorphic one form.
Can I ask you?
Yes.
So, in what sense is it a singularity?
It is a singularity for the flat metric. So we have a metric which is really flat, and it is not flat everywhere. At this point, there is a singularity of the metric.
And the metric is 10 versus 0.
Yes. Okay. Yes. So if you prefer, the curvature is concentrated. The negative curvature is concentrated in a finite number of points, and here in only one point. And so that will be very important in a few minutes. So here I don't want to play the same to work in the same space as Chris did. Chris spoke about Teichmuller space, and here I want to work in the moduli space. And I don't want to explain formally what it means, but this is a torus, okay? And a torus is obtained as a quotient of R2 by the lattice Z2, but I could change the basis of the torus. So this is Z2. And I chose to take this fundamental domain. This is the most obvious one. But why? I could take this one, for instance. This part can be cut here and paste here in the torus. Not, of course, in the plane, but in the torus. So what I mean is that this torus R2 of Z2 is the same R2 of Z2 if I consider this fundamental domain. Okay? I consider surfaces up to cut and paste. So, to translation surfaces. If we can go from one to the other by cut and paste. And this is very important. And I will explain in detail how to cut and paste in a clever way. And this is called the Rozhevich induction. Okay, so before doing that, I want to say maybe more precisely what it means for the torus. So what is the parameter for the baby? So first of all, I only restrict myself to surfaces of area 1, because if the surface is obtained by dilatation, it is the same for the properties I want to study. So I will assume that area of the surface is 1. And then what is the space of area 1? Lattices, it is just SL2R. So if you to give a lattice, you need two vectors. And if you want that the area of a fundamental domain is 1, you have to choose a matrix in SL2R. And we construct by the stabilizer of our favorite lattice of the stabilizer of Z2. And the stabilizer of Z2 is exactly, so this is second exercise, and this is a very easy exercise. So the space of tori is the quotient SL2R over SL2Z. Of tori, of course, of area 1. If you want a picture, I make the following picture. So I take the shortest vector, so I make a different normalization, not area 1. Now I can always get the shortest vector like that, applying rotation and dilatation. And then the second shortest vector is out of the unit disk, of course, and one can prove that it is in this strip. It is here. And so this is also an exercise of if you add one, for instance, you see that this is longer than this one. So this is an exercise. So the second shortest vector, this is not correct, which is not parallel to the first one, because this one is maybe shorter than that one, is in what is called the modular surface. So this gives a good representation of the space of Torrey. So this point is very special. It corresponds to the case of Z2. And this is also special. It corresponds to the hexagonal lattice. Okay, you see an angle of pi over 3 here. And so this has to be identified with this, because if we have a vector like that, we also have the vector minus 1 in a horizontal direction. So these two sides are the same. And one can check also that this is identified with this. And so we have what we have is in a very complicated way to say that is that this is unit tangent bundle to the modular surface, which is this object. Okay, so so it means that on this guy, I have a point and a direction, and the direction is one more parameter, because here I forced this vector to be horizontal, which a priori it is not horizontal. So that's why, and this is of dimension 3, this is of dimension 2. Okay, but you should recall that. So I have the direction, but the important part is this picture for the space of Torrey. And if you want a geometric picture, so this is almost a surface with two special points. This is this one. This one, and it is not the what is already interesting is that this is not a compact space. And this will play an important role for the rest of the talk and of the story. Okay, so that's the parameter space. And now, so we are interested in understanding questions like that. In higher genus, but also we want to do dynamics. And what is the dynamics? So this is here very elementary. The dynamics is to understand the linear flow on this guy. Linear flow, it means that I start from a point, and so I fix a direction, and I move at constant speed along a line. Okay? And when I reach the boundary, I continue. And so on and so forth. Okay, so this is a linear flow. So this is phi t on one parameter, which is theta, which is, for instance, this angle. And the first absolutely obvious remark, we can do the same here. Here we also have a linear flow. And the direction is well defined. Because the identifications are made by translation. Yes?
From hexagon.
Torus from hexagon. How to make a torus from hexagon? In fact, this is a torus. So maybe we can see that during the exercise session. No. Yeah. I can explain that if you wish. So what is the best to do? The best thing is you can cut in fact, what I mean is the tiling by equilateral triangles. And if you wish, you can get it from the hexagon. Okay.
Is it obvious that if such a translation surface which has genus 1, then you can cut and paste it, you have a parallelogram of fundamental domain?
Yes. Because Okay. So what do you mean by a genus 1 surface? So genus 1 surface is a torus. Okay. A compact genus 1 surface is a torus. Thus, if it is flat, it is of the form R2 over a lattice. So you cannot get anything else. And so you maybe we need something more complicated. No, I think for this. So do we need something more complicated to? No, I think it's okay. Yeah. I think we. Okay, and so. Was there a question? Yes. No. This has to be proved. This is true. This is not completely obvious. So you have to. So this is a statement. So you have to work a little bit to prove that. This is not difficult, but this is a good exercise. More difficult than what I mentioned before. So what are the questions in dynamics? So first of all, I have to recall what is known here. Because otherwise, it's not possible to understand what we want to get. First, for the baby case, So then it is known, and it is known forever, that so a linear flow on T2 is a periodic if the slope is rational. So this is something very simple. So if we one, then you see that every trajectory will be closed. And what happens if the slope is non is rational? And then the answer is very classical. And the answer is the following. So the slope is if the slope is the tangent or the cotangent of theta, it doesn't matter, rational, then the flow is what is called minimal. I am going to explain what it means. And more, it is uniquely ergodic. And we would like to understand this kind of properties in the general context of transition surfaces. And so minimal means that, I can use another blackboard, I think, no? That every trajectory is dense. And uniquely ergodic means that every trajectory spans the correct time in a given open set. So for every ball, or for every continuous function maybe, so for every f, so if I look at along the trajectory and I average for what I see, this tends to the integral of f. And d lambda. Lambda is the Lebesgue measure. And the Lebesgue measure on T2. So unique ergodicity means that if I look at a very long, if you you have an open set and you look at a very long leaf and you look at how much time the leaf is in the ball, and it's in average is the area of the ball. So that's what it means. So if and this is a very important phenomenon in dynamics. So it means that if you prefer, if you are a physicist and if you take temperature and if you average along your trajectory, then you get what is really the temperature in the space. So this is something very important, and it is important that it is true for every x and not for almost every. Otherwise, it is ergodicity. In fact, for the torus, this is yes. Yes. This is more. Yes. It is a stronger property. Yes, it is a stronger property, except in stupid cases that I don't want to consider. It implies yes. For what we want, it implies minimality. Yes. As soon as the support of the measure is full, it's fine. So to prove this, I'm not going to prove this theorem because it was known more than a century ago. It's proved by Weil, in fact, a chronic. The remark is very important. The remark I'm going to do is very important for the rest of the talk. So now I want to look at a transversal. And so that's what we have to do. So this is a circle. And I want to look at the first return map on this circle. So what is the first return map on this circle? So this is the slope. And this part, so the bottom is the same as the top. So this part goes here. And it is shifted, okay, by some number alpha. And the second part should go here. Well, the picture is terrible. Should go here. And this is exactly this part. So on the first part, the map is x goes to x plus alpha. And x goes to x plus alpha minus 1. So which means that modulo 1, we add alpha. And this is, yes.
T2, you mean the standard one or any one in that space?
No, the standard one. It's the same, but I make my. It's the same, but here I make my picture on R2 over Z2. What I'm explaining here, if I want to speak about irrational slope, I need coordinates. So it is really for R2 over Z2.
Okay.
Otherwise, you have to apply a matrix and then to see what it means. But yes. It's really the picture is correct. So this is a rotation of the circle. So the first return map is a rotation of the circle, and we know that we call this R alpha, and we know that a rotation is big if and only if angle is rational. And in fact, the theorem I mentioned here is a theorem about rotations. And I'm sure that you know that the sequence n alpha is dense in 0,1 if alpha is irrational. And that's just minimality. Minimality is nothing else. And unique ergodicity is a little bit more complicated, but it's not so difficult. It's, you have to work with good functions, and but it is a little bit more complicated, but not so much. Okay, so that's the first page, and what I want to do is to. So first to explain to you what is the analogous of rotations for translation surfaces, and I make a picture. I think it's so I make a picture of the octagon again, and I take a transversal to my flow, and I try to look at the first return map on this transversal exactly as I did here. And so what I am going to get, so this is the direction of the flow. I get four parts. And this little piece here continues like that, and then here, and back here. So this, which I call one, will go at the end. Okay. The second one, which is blue, it will follow like that and comes back here and arrives here. And then you understand the picture.
So what are the identification of the...
Oh, okay. As it was before, so it is like that. Sorry. Thank you, Erwin. And the third one is yellow, and it comes here, and this is the image of the yellow one, and I think the last one will be white. This one goes here. So I have one. I have a map of the interval. So the first return map is what is called an interval exchange transformation. Interval exchange transformation. And it is a map like that. So this is one, this is two. This is three, this is four. So one. So on each part we have a translation. And the pieces are permuted. So the pieces are permuted and translate, and on each subinterval, it is a translation. For sure. Rotation is just a second. Rotation is an interval exchange transformation on two intervals because this is goes here and this goes here.
If this surface or just for these two specific cases?
The goal is to define it in general. So as soon as we have a flow, a linear flow, and a transversal, what we get is an interval exchange transformation.
But how do you get that canonical central edge to define?
That's another story. That's another story, I will explain that. So this is just an example to explain what happens, okay, and to motivate the definition. Later I will not prove, but tell you that there is a good way to make a transversal. Yes. So this is important, and it will not be something closed like that in general. So this is an interval exchange transformation. So an interval exchange transformation is a priori, we need a permutation pi plus length. The length of the intervals. And in fact, I will follow Yoko's convention, and I will consider two permutations. So here it is 1, 2, 3, 4, but the order can be whatever we want. I follow the condition of those. So I have two permutations. And a vector, lambda, which is the vector of the length. And so this is an interval exchange transformation, and this is not something trivial. A priori, it seems that we just make a permutation and nothing will happen. But as you already seen, for two intervals, we have rotation, which is not periodic, for instance. Okay.
What do you mean by two permutations?
Okay. So I want to do it in the correct way. I have an alphabet, and the first permutation and it tells us that A is the first, B is second, and so on and so forth. And pi bottom tells us that D is the first one. And it seems to be completely ridiculous to have two guys, but in fact, it is a very clever idea. Okay. So at the beginning, the people who started to work this stuff was Rosie and then Vich. Add one permutation because it seems to be quite natural to have on the top the natural ordering. But in fact, but it was maybe 20 years later, Yoko's remarked that it is much more it is better for calculations, but for everything, to have these two permutations. And this is just a technical fact, but sometimes you can be completely lost with techniques. And a big simplification in techniques is also a very nice idea. So that's why I want, from the beginning, to take two permutations, even if it seems to be completely stupid. I don't compose. These are the data of my. These are the data of my interpolation transformation.
It's equivalent data to giving a single permutation.
Yes.
Another way of writing it.
Yes, okay. But in a moment I will compose, and then we will be very happy to have this extra information. But right now, of course, if we have plenty of permutations, we give the same guy.
Lambda 1 to lambda 4 is
The length. Sorry. The length of 1, 2, 3, and 4. The length of the interval, of the sub-intervals. Okay, so these sub-intervals, here you see that the length of the intervals depend on the slope, for instance. Okay, so this is a family, but we could get any length we want.
Can you be negative?
No. I just want to have a positive length. So this. Okay, so lambda belongs to RD, if we have D intervals, plus. And we can also always normalize so that the sum of the lengths is equal to 1, if we wish. So it is a condition which is convenient. And there is a first result, which is a weak result. It is not a strong form. So it is not theorem. The proposition: if the lambda I are independent so over Q, so which means that the only equation, in fact, is lambda 1 plus lambda d equal 1. Then we have minimality. Of course, stated like that, it is false, because we could get something absolutely stupid. We could get an interpolation like that. One and two play together, and three and four play in a separate game. This is Brazil against Wu Mateus, and this is France against Australia, and completely different game. So this is not very interesting. And so I want to have a notion of irreducibility.
So, you promised us a definition of
the definition of an interpolation transformation is two permutations. Okay, so I have an alphabet.
What is a transversal?
What is a transversal? A transversal is a segment. Which is a segment which is in a direction which is not the direction of the flow.
But I mean, I could find one which, for example, does not separate into two halves.
What?
Would that be allowed?
So the question is how you define in general this transversal which you get from.
What are you using about the transversal in this game? That's my question.
Okay, so I don't.
transverse a contact point contact and not take a non-horizontal transversal.
Yes.
I could take this. It would not separate into two halves, but I could still think all the transversal.
Okay, I can
something that does not separate into two halves. That would certainly be transverse to the flow and is probably illegal. That's why I want a definition.
So you want to get something like that, for instance?
No, I just want to go something like this. From you start at the same point, but you end up, you know, just three over. Not four over, but three over.
I start from here and I go here?
Yes.
Okay.
So this is probably not allowed as a transversal. So that's why I want a definition of what is a transversal.
So this is allowed as a transversal. This is allowed as a transversal, yes, and you can get even, and we will see this very soon, that we are interested in very short transversals also.
So maybe then
that
give us a definition.
Okay. So I take any segment. So first of all, so this is not the best way to do it, but I take any segment which is in a different direction from the flow, the first return map on it. Okay? And what I claim is that the first return map.
No.
So then I will make something canonical as it was asked, but not now. From the direction of the flow. And then, so take a segment I, and I'm looking at the first return to I. So I start in I and I come back to I. And what I claim is that this is always an interrelation transformation. Okay?
And it has to cover the whole surface?
Not always. Look. No, not always. If the flow is minimal, yes. But if you consider, for instance, the vertical direction in this picture, okay, and you consider this interval, okay, why not? This is what is the map? Will go first. Here, then it will come here, then it will come back exactly at the same place. So it is just the identity. Okay, so if I am too stupid, if I am very stupid, I get for a very special direction. The claim is that if the direction of the flow is minimal, then you take any transversal you want, and what you get will cover the surface. So I can take, if the red direction corresponds to a minimal flow, I take a segment, and I look at the first return map. Maybe the time will be very long to come back, but it will cover everything. But yeah, that's a very important question. So other questions on this?
In your supposition, do you assume that the permutation pi has a single orbit?
Here?
Yes.
So I was trying to explain what is irreducibility. So I want to do that. Other questions? Okay. So if I want minimality, I want something more, as you said. And this is, so I want that pi, which is pi, so which means that 1k is not equal to 1k if k is less than d. So I cannot find a strict subset of the indices such that which is invariant. And that's a bad picture. So if I don't have non-minimality for a trivial reason, and if the lambda I are generic in a very explicit sense, then minimality holds. Celui-là, il se lève pas, Erwan ? C'est ça ? Est-ce que le deuxième tableau se lève ou pas ?
Non.
OK. Alors, attends, peut-être que je vais écrire. Finir ça. Attends, je vais... Okay, so now I would like to study objects like that, or flows like that, and I need a tool. Okay, so in dynamical system, we only know one tool, which is normalization, and. And I'm and what I want to describe is this how we make a normalization and how we make a normalization. So explain this in 1 or 2 minutes for surfaces. And I will explain Rosé induction next time, tomorrow. So how do I make a normalization? So I change the surface. So I have a very long piece of orbit of the vertical flow. So this is very long. This is so long that I cannot see from here. I cannot see this point. I want to change my eyes and to contract this and to change. So this is on a surface, and I want to change the surface and to have a short, a reasonably short piece of orbit. And then, so x is not the same x, the surface is not the same. And then, of course, here I can see what happens. So this is renormalization. And so the concrete way to do it is to apply gt so if I have a surface, so this is part of a surface, this is a rectangle in a surface. So what is so how do I apply? So if I have A in SL to R, or even in GL to R, it acts on translation surfaces. So and if A is in SL to R, and if X is a translation surface, I can define A of X. I want to define it, and I define it in the following way. On polygons, if I have a polygon P, I have the action of A, which is a linear action. So this is well defined. I know how matrices act in the plane. Okay, and so if I add two parallel sides and I apply a matrix, then the size and the direction change, but they remain parallel and of the same length. So this A of X is a translation surface. Operator is just the geodesic flow, which is GT, you will see later why it is called geodesic flow. I imagine that Chris will explain that. If I have a rectangle or a square, this is a square in the surface X, and I this is part of the surface, and I apply the Teichmuller, the geodesic flow, the Teichmuller geodesic flow, and this is the image of a rectangle by GT. And if I remember correctly, you already saw this picture in the previous talk, at the end of the previous talk. Okay, and that's not by chance. I said if I have a very long piece of orbit, after some times, it will be of size 1. And that's essentially the tool. But this is very abstract today. And tomorrow, I want to explain what Rossi induction is. And Rossi induction is a concrete way to parameterize, in a sense, the geodesic flow and to be able to prove results like unique ergodicity or many interesting results in dynamics. And this is really something very basic too. Okay, I think it's time to stop. Yes. And the IET, I can call it T pi lambda, OK? It depends on. Yes. Mm.
Okay. What about the number of intervals?
Aha. The number of the intervals is it's essentially constant, except that strange things can happen on the boundary. And so the good way to get a constant number of intervals, and that was in fact your question. So what is a good transversal? Okay, the good way to do it is to start from a singularity and to end at a pre-image of a singularity. And that's the good way. So if we do that, we get a fixed always n. Of course, if the flow goes everywhere, so if the flow is minimal, then the number of intervals is constant. Only depends on the geometry of the surface.
So it's constant
n minimal. What? It's constant n the smallest. Yes. Otherwise, you can have one more or two more. For instance, the good exercise is to do this for a torus. We take a torus, and instead of taking this, we take any and look at the first return map on this interval. And a priori, it's not an interval action on two intervals, but it may be on three, and I imagine maybe on four. But four, I'm not sure, but three for sure. And so so if you want to have the minimal number of intervals.
So is it related to the number of sides of the polygon?
It is. It is. I will explain that next. No, but I want to say something to tomorrow, and I want to explain. I will explain that in details tomorrow. Yes, I will do that tomorrow also. What? Yes, 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 yes. that's a very good question. On a translation surface, I want to have a fixed direction. In my mind, a translation surface is a surface with a direction. So I have, this is, for instance, the vertical direction. This is not the same translation surface as this one. Okay. So that's the only reason. And it's better because we can speak about the vertical foliation, for instance, the vertical direction. Yes. Yes, yes, yes. You want exactly what Chris did this morning. So you want the Riemann surface is sent to Riemann surface, and the form is sent to the form. So you take the pre-image of the form, if you prefer, by the mapping. Yes, 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 yeah. Yeah. So except that Chris did for the Teichmuller space, and I do it for modular space, yes, yes. And I want the Riemann surface to be the same and the form to be the pullback of, yes.
Time for a break, and we can ask other questions to Pascal. Thank you again.